So I've got to ask, where did this story come from? Was it, I know it was you, Paul, Frank, that were kind of came up with this story, but where did the tale come from?
The original story was written by actually Greg Scott Houghton, and it was about a roommate of Greg's by the name of Ramesh Raju, who grew up in a small town in Oklahoma called Ponca City. So his roommate had shared with him his stories of growing up in the 70s in Ponca City, Oklahoma. Greg wrote a script called Good Old Boy, and I got the rights to that and adapted it more from the perspective of the inside of the Indian family's head, right? I had grown up outside of New Haven, Connecticut in the 70s and 80s as an immigrant boy. So I adapted that, and then I brought on board Paul Quinn, who further adapted, and we ended up spending another year rewriting the story. And then ultimately what you see on screen is the version of the script that we wrote called Growing Up Smith Now.
So how much of your childhood in the 70s is imprinted in this character? Because we're in that time frame,
yeah, 79. Yeah, I think I'd say a great amount of it is. At the same time, I also think that a lot of immigrant experiences go through very similar journeys. So when you're an immigrant growing up in a, you know, fish out of water situation, you're gonna say, wait a minute, I felt that, and you may be, you know, Italian, or you may, you know, whatever ethnicity it is, when you're a fish out of water, when your experience is fish out of water, you end up relating to the stories in a way where it's very familiar. So while it was initially Ramesh Raju's story in the version that Greg sent, it was very similar in my own experience growing up in Connecticut versus Oklahoma. When we adapted it, we made it, you know, anywhere America.
You know, speaking of anywhere America, you guys have screened this in Seattle. You guys have screened this on the East Coast. Yeah. You brought it here to Texas. Is that kind of part of the appeal? Is it is so universal in that sense that it can go anywhere with this film?
Yeah, I mean, we've always seen this and wanted to make sure that it was it's an independent film, of course. It's not financed by a studio. It was independently financed. But we also thought it had, you know, commercial potential, that people will identify the central themes in the movie, which quite simply are first love, childhood heroes, and growing up in a small town. If you've experienced that, or you know somebody who's experienced that, I think you'll begin to identify to the stories in this movie.
Did you look to your own parents, maybe your own dad, as kind of inspirational?
Yeah. Well, I would say that my character was greatly based in a lot of scenes, and a lot of dialogue and nuances are adapted from my own father, for sure. He's 83 years old. I don't know if you've had a chance to see it, but if you have, you'll see there's scenes in there like the coins for trick-or-treating. My father, to this day, he's 83, as I said, and he lives in Connecticut in the same house we grew up in, and he's still handing out coins instead of candy for trick-or-treaters. We grew up being extremely focused on studies, of course, but as well focused intensely on the religious traditional rituals of Hinduism, where when Diwali would come around, it often fell on Halloween. And of course, it's the festival of lights, so we would have all the lights up in the house, and for the outside, we had Christmas lights, and we'd hang them up there. And when you're living in a small town, you know everybody who's trick-or-treating, right? It's Halloween, and you'd have your friends from school, from the neighborhood, coming to you and trick-or-treating and asking for candy, and they're looking around, and they're like, it's Halloween, dude, it's not Christmas. So that was certainly adapted from my own experiences. And of course, I grew up in the 70s, so the music, which is a huge character in our movie, you know, staying alive, you should be dancing, don't take your guns to town, by Johnny Cash. All those were part of my own assimilation experience of being an immigrant, you know, listening to the music that my friends at school were listening to.
Was it fun then to, because I think Brighton's character especially, she brings out a lot of the knowledge, especially Diwali, and there's so much of her character telling her dad, for instance, the education of like, well, no, this is what it really is. Ganesh, especially the outfit. Can you talk about molding that, because you guys don't throw it at us, you give us a chance to kind of assimilate with you as an audience.
Well, I mean, I think assimilation works in two ways, right? When you're an immigrant, you're assimilating and trying to understand the people you're living amongst now. And if you have an open heart, which I think Amy's character does, and ultimately Butch's character does too, which is Amy's dad, if you have an open heart, you want to understand what the other person is about. You want to understand their religions and their cultures. And for example, we have the scene in the barbecue when we're cooking up vegetables, because we're vegetarian, of course, we're going to cook up vegetables. But Amy's dad is all about what we eat, meat. But Amy is like, I want to try a vegetarian meal, you know? And I think she's our light of hope on the other side of the family, right? I mean, the other side of the story, in the sense that she's going to open up, open her arms to Smith and let him feel welcome in this country. And ultimately, you begin to see that happening also with Amy's dad, which is Butch, who takes him hunting and whatnot and rescues him several times through the story, so.
Can you talk about the humor? Because your character, I mean, obviously is playing the serious dad, but I mean, we know you from, you know, Metro PC and Jimmy Kimmel, but being able to kind of make fun of yourself in that sense as well, how much fun was it to dive into this character, the clothes especially, and the feel, the mustache, I mean, the whole appeal of that?
What's funny is there's so many elements of this that are my father, and when he's seen this movie, he's seen it several times, the things that he finds are familiar to him are not the things that are, like, he doesn't still recognize that the coins are borrowed right from him. He thinks that's natural. So like the mustache and the wardrobe and stuff, it's a iconic period of our Americana, right? The 70s with the cars and the Indian motorcycle. Like, man, everybody had a friend who had this like relic motorcycle that they wanted, and to be able to be amongst that was amazing. It was a joy. This is a period of time that when we look back at it, we look back at it with fondness, right? We think about it as times when things were simpler. And when you start sharing movies or telling stories about understanding and tolerance and assimilation, I think if you can take it from a perspective of feel good and optimism, I think the audience will leave the theater hoping that life is okay. You know, we're living in very cynical times.
Yeah. Can you talk then about the Butch character in particular? Because I was really amazed that from the beginning he is part of helping bring Smith into the fold.
Yeah.
And that's I think a bold choice in one way, especially when you look at times right now where people are scared. Butch character could easily be so different and could be the opposite of that.
I mean, I think the thing with Butch was when we wrote it, we didn't want him to have a stereotype redneck quality about it. In fact, there was no cliches that we wanted to have in the movie. We wanted to have everybody have a richness and a dimension that was beyond what you would expect. When you think of Butch, a tow truck driver, you know, in middle America or in anywhere in America, especially in the 70s, you're going to expect him to be a little bit more perhaps divided from seeing someone like an immigrant Indian boy spending time with his daughter. But I think we wanted to approach it from a level of, he's open, you know? While he hasn't been involved, doesn't eat vegetarian meals, he's open for his daughter to do it. You know, in the same way, when I grew up in the 70s, my parents were vegetarian growing up, and my father's still alive, and he's vegetarian to this day. But we stayed vegetarian until we started going to school. And when we started going to school, my parents were like, well, yeah, go explore. Figure out what you want to try and see if you like it. You know, we never spit it out like Smith does, chicken when he tried it. But I think Butch has a little bit of that. I think the other thing we were trying to capture is, here's two families. They're from different parts of the world, but they're going through similar experiences, right? There's a moment in the movie where you see Smith and his mother sitting at dinner eating alone, right? And the dad, my character, is away, he's working overtime. And Asha, the daughter, has gone studying, supposedly.
With Betsy.
With the Betsy, right? And then there's Butch is not at home. He's walked away because he got into a fight with his wife, Nancy. And Amy and her mom, Nancy, are sitting at home. She's eating a TV dinner, watching TV. Eating TV dinner, watching TV. That's why they call it TV dinners, right? And yet there's this sense of isolation within the family, but they're connected by their loneliness, right? And I think that's what we wanted to capture, that people, in essence, are all alike. You know, we may come from different walks of the world, in essence, we have the same soul.
Where did the idea for a squash as a pumpkin come from?
As immigrants, while we may have the opportunity to, you know, live lives where you can, you know, buy decent furniture for your home, or, you know, if you're supposed to get pumpkins for Halloween, you get a pumpkin. But with immigrants many times, and I know in my own family, everything was about practicality, right? And budgeting everything, right? You see the character that I play talking to his son about, you got to have a vegetable garden in the front, and how much cheaper is it to grow your own, you know, bell peppers and onions and tomatoes than going to the, you know, that silly fruit stand. So in the same way, the squash is kind of in the same family as a pumpkin. So why do we need a pumpkin? You know, we grow squash in our front vegetable garden. Why do we need to go get a pumpkin? Of course, the mom is a little bit more nurturing in that way. And she goes in the middle of the school day to try and get a pumpkin from the food store.
Now that you've seen this, obviously, a few times, you've shown it to your dad, what are the lessons that you're learning? Because I watched it twice just to kind of get more and more, because there's so many little hidden things. What do you see in it the more that you get to see it?
I find that people, because I've seen it, I'd say at least 50 times with an audience now. Some people end up crying and laughing at places that I never intended. Maybe they're laughing that, wow, this is awful. I hope not. But that's what always intrigues me, that people end up laughing at stuff that I never intended it, or crying. I mean, they get moved more than I thought. I didn't expect the emotional response to be as strong as it has been, and I'm very grateful to that. So,
well, as a young Jewish boy, I felt so connected to Ronnie, and the mother character is so well developed. Can you talk about, I guess, the family aspect and how this really does bring people together, even through the tears or through the laughter?
Well, there's a quality about Indians that's very similar, I think, to Italians and to Jewish families, which is there's this idea of living and sharing each other's space very much so, like in almost in a central place. Right, and it's always about food and eating and laughter and there's a boisterousness to it. And in India, there's this idea where you live in multifamily households, right? When you grow up, you're still in the same house, but your siblings are married as well as you. But we all live in the same kind of communal living, and that's an aspect I think that was very central to what my wife's character was missing. You know, the character was longing for that, right? She always wanted to go back where the kids could be amongst their cousins and spending, you know, there's a lack of loneliness and an isolation, which you feel often in this country, right? So I think we were addressing it through that character specifically. There was also an element of, for immigrants, we always want to find a home away from home. When we came to the States, we never intended to be here too long. We were only going to be here for 6 months, and we were going to go back. We were going to, you know, get our American dream and then bring it back to India, right? And that, I mean, my character says that. We'll go back, we'll live like kings and queens, we'll live the American dream in India, right? And I think a lot of people who migrate, whether it's from another country to the States or from the East Coast to the West, we have this idea that we're going to eventually go back home. I moved to LA 28 years ago from New York. When I first moved out there, it was with the intent that I'm going to get to LA, I'm going to get established enough as an actor, and then I'm going to move back to New York. And, you know, it took me 4 or 5 years to get to a place where I became a working actor. And then, you know, you're working, you have relationships, you get married, you have kids, you buy a house, you got a mortgage, and you settled in. As much as you, as in your youth, you never want to use that phrase, settled in. You don't want that to be your, in your context of your life. But once you do, the idea of going back home, it still exists in you. But I don't think you're ever going to do it. My father is an Indian citizen still, to this day. He's 83 years old. And he never became an American passport holder. He never became naturalized. And that's because he's always had this intent of going back. But now, whenever he goes back to India, he visits and he's like, I want to go back to America. But when he's here, he still talks about, when I get older, and of course, he's 83, he's gonna go back and retire. And he's been retired here for 7, 8 years.
Wow. Well, I guess the final question for, you know, the good old boy feel, I think, is perfect for a Texas audience. What have you seen in the audiences now that you've shown it a few times here in Texas?
I mean, I think the universal themes, I think, have been touching the audiences, which is beautiful. We hope it continues to. As you may know, we're expanding. We're opening tomorrow here in Frisco at the AMC Stonebriar, and then we're expanding to the AMC Grapevine next week, and we're continuing our expansion. So I'm hoping that people go see this movie. They recognize that my job as a storyteller is to transform you in a positive way. I'm hoping you go into the theater and you walk out feeling better about your humankind that you live amongst. That's all I can hope for.
Well, thank you for making the film. I really felt that was put upon me when watching. So
great.
Thank you, Anjul.
Thank you.